Yeah, thanks so much. So yeah, as Maria Jose said, I'm kind of pretty multidisciplinary. I work with a lot of sound, electronics, film, photography, video. But for today, I'm going to kind of concentrate on my what was my PhD research between sort of 2012 and 2018, which was all about Daphne Oram, who is a British composer and inventor and sort of philosopher almost. Again, someone who's very worked across a lot of disciplines, but today I'm just going to be talking about her work within visual music and drawn sound. So yeah, my PhD research was called Oramics, Precedence, Technology and Influence, and I studied between Goldsmiths at the University of London and the Science Museum in London, and the reason for that was that the Science Museum had Daphne Oram's original instrument in their collection, and the archive at Goldsmiths had her all her notes and papers and recordings, so studying between the two of them kind of made sense. Yeah, so that's me, as Maria Jose has said. So like, yeah, I've been working with sound and music since I was a teenager, really, so it's like, I won't tell you how long, quite long. So yeah, we're going to be talking about oramics and drawn sound. So yeah, Daphne Oram was someone who's she had a big career heyday in the 1960s, and even a bit before that in the 1950s. She started off as a sort of studio engineer at the BBC, I think in the very late 40s. And then as she was working in the BBC, she had all these kinds of ideas and threads of research on the side. And she was kind of one of the founder members of the BBC Radiophonic Workshop, which made a lot of seminal sound works for film and television on the BBC. She also took on commissions for things outside the BBC, much to the sort of chagrin of her employers. She worked in like theatre and other areas. She did a soundtrack for like a kinetic sculpture at the Mallard offices in London. But her real obsession throughout that time, so as it was getting towards the end of the 1950s at the BBC and the BBC Radiophonic Workshop had been formed, she was starting to get really tired of the kind of hierarchy and the lack of credit she was given for her work, and she really wanted to pursue her own ideas with a bit more independence. So in 1959, she left the BBC to pursue those interests, and she moved to a studio outside London in Kent. And she won, after about a year of being independent, she won quite a large grant from the Carlos Gulbenkian Foundation to explore what she called at the time her sound wave instrument. So she'd been very influenced by people like Leopold Stokowski and Edgar Varèse, who were sort of interested in this idea that you know, at some point in the near future, composers would be able to kind of bypass the musician stage of things and write their music and have it interpreted directly by a machine. Obviously, lots of other musicians and technologists were exploring similar ideas at the time, and Daphne Oram certainly had her share of influences in that regard. There are two really important ones that I should mention. One was called the Hammergraph, which was developed at an electronic music studio in Canada. And that was a way of automating basically musical envelopes or events on tape. So like how, basically a way of automating dynamics on tape recordings. And the other one was the parametric artificial talker, which was, or PAT, which was a machine that was developed at Edinburgh University. And that was a speech synthesis machine that used formant filters to create artificial speech. And Oram was really interested in that, in that they had a kind of drawn interface for how those phonetic and vocal sounds were characterised in a graphic way. So all through her late BBC years, she was doodling designs for her proposed instrument where you could turn your drawings into sound. And after she left the BBC and got her quite big grant, it was £3,500 in 1961, I believe, or 1960. So that's kind of the equivalent to maybe a generous PhD grant nowadays. So maybe like, I don't know, in euros, maybe 60,000 euros or something like that. So it was significant, but not like a huge amount. And another thing to sort of bear in mind with that is at that time, like nowadays electronic components are really cheap, and at that time they were not, they were really super expensive. So, you know, her sort of colleague and sort of frenemy actually, Peter Zinoviev, bought the first computer for use, well, the first computer that was in a domestic house in the UK. And that computer, which was like super, super basic, cost more than the house was worth. So that puts it a little bit into context how much this kind of equipment could cost. So throughout the 60s, Oram employed a number of engineers to help her create this system. So one was her brother, John, who created the kind of mechanical framework. And I'm going to explain how the machine worked in a little bit more detail in a minute. There was a chap called Fred Wood who helped some with the electronics. And then the real saviour of the project later on was a chap called Graham Wrench, who managed to really pin down Oram's design and turn it into functioning electronics. So it took really about 8 years for the Oramics machine, the first Oramics machine, to become a functional prototype. And that sort of, she got the first real, what you might call Oramics sounds out of it in about 1966, but it wasn't until kind of 1968, 69 that something that resembled music really came out of it. The way the machine worked was, first of all, you would draw these timbres or wave shapes onto glass slides. So if you've ever seen a wave on an oscilloscope, that's the wiggly lines of that. That's kind of the idea. And then she could put these slides into this very odd looking machine. We think at one point was a kind of stereogram with a record player in the top, and she'd just taken all the guts out and fitted it with this electronic equipment. So you'd place your glass slides, four of them, into this machine, and then the kind of yellow tubes that are like cathode ray tubes, like you'd have on an oscilloscope or a television. And then above the cathode ray tubes were light-sensitive components called photomultipliers, and then there was a feedback circuit so that essentially the slide that you'd drawn with the wave pattern would be read at a frequency by the photomultiplier and the cathode ray tube combined. So essentially the beam on the cathode ray tube would follow the outline you'd drawn, and then that would create a wave shape or a timbre. And so on top of that, what we call the commode was the, this is all the oscillator control circuitry here. And then the next stage of the process would be to draw on these like synchronized reels of 35mm film, so a movie film. And what we have is, there's actually room for five rolls at the top, but she eventually only used four of them. There was three to control the sort of like in a coded way, digitally can change pitch in time as the machine read the dots. So there's three rows of dots. This red line was the
analog pitch control, so that was like pitch bend or vibrato, so you could make the notes wobble. And the other more expressive lines at the bottom are all expressions of dynamics, so or basically volume controls. So you'd have the four different oscillators would each have their own volume channel. So that would mean that you could actively mix different timbres within one note if you wanted. So it's very sophisticated for the time. And then the last of the channels was to control how much reverberation was applied to that mix of the four oscillator sounds. So in terms of like what else was going on in the mid-60s, this studio system was incredibly sophisticated and on a par, or if not more sophisticated, than quite a lot of the institutional and university-based music studios in the world. And Oram was constantly in touch with lots of those other practitioners, and she was very, had a very keen eye on the competition as she saw it. And so this is from her book, An Individual Note of Sound, Music and Electronics, which is, it's been reissued, so I'd recommend getting a copy. It's a very entertaining read, it's very, very 70s, it's quite new agey. Quite a lot of sort of weird philosophy in there, but also explains her philosophy of music and how she came to make the Oramics machine. So when I was doing my research, I think Oram was very protective of her ideas and quite secretive about how it worked. So she would tell everybody in the world that her machine was like the most advanced thing in electronic music, and she would tell everybody it's protected by worldwide patents. And that wasn't kind of quite true. She did have some limited patents for her research, but what really was kind of original was the way that she'd combined all of these separate elements, which maybe weren't patentable on their own, but the way she'd combined them all into this machine really did make it one of the most advanced electronic music production studios in the world. Bear in mind, like, nearly all electronic music production at that time was just made by recording sounds onto tape, splicing them together in different ways, bouncing them down, mixing the recordings down onto one tape, and extrapolations of that process, changing the pitch and so on, with very basic kind of electronic oscillators or field recorded sounds, that kind of thing. So Oram was also a complete master of concrete technique of tape manipulation, but she really wanted to be able to have a more immediate and sort of ergonomic interface for creating the sounds. This page in her notebook from 1961, I've kind of like, in the course of my research and looking through all her notes and her archives, which are like, there's thousands and thousands of pages at Goldsmiths, this one I've sort of taken to be one of the more succinct kind of design briefs that she's kind of given herself. So as I said, it's from 1961, and I'll read a little bit out to you. Written sound waves, January 1961. Needs: to have complete control of timbre, pitch, dynamics, vibrato, reverberation, attack, decay, and timbre changes within the note. 2. To control these characteristics in a visual form so that all alterations within the aural comprehension of the human ear and mind have an easily recognizable counterpart in the visual medium. And to achieve this controlled complexity of waveform whilst keeping all parameters within the scope of written waveforms. 4, to obtain sounds which are more musical than those so far achieved by electronic devices and which have a far greater range of timbre. And she goes on to say,
Neither the additive sine wave methods or the subtractive white noise methods give satisfactory musical timbre, because I think the results are just too simple. There is not enough change within the note itself, and they are too mathematically pure and calculated. A freehand drawing method might produce very much more artistic results because of the inaccuracies inherent within it. Once a handwritten system has been decided upon, all stages in the composition technique should then be under its control. E.g., different strands of the score should not be left later to be mixed by conventional methods, but should be accurately combined by handwritten control, as were the original components of the sound waves. And it goes on. If the action of a bow on a string is thought of in slow motion, it would seem that the string, in adjusting or readjusting to certain speed of vibration, must give off a glissando sound which is too quick for the ear to recognize as such, and which we just term attack. With a slow motion technique, this might well be produced far more accurately than any gating circuit can do it. So we can see she's kind of quite frustrated with the technology that's standard or even advanced for the time, and she's really looking at for a way of making music electronically that's more organic and more intuitive. And she was also kind of a very vocal critic of a lot of other music techniques. There was a lot of music that she would call either music by slide rule or music by the yard. In that, she was kind of like referring to serialists and aleatoric music, and most of what was being done in sort of computer-based music, so people like Max Matthews. So she was, you know, always writing off to these different studios and getting recordings of what was happening, and she was comparing that to what she would consider her own brief for what electronic music should be, so that's where she was going. So I've got a little audio clip of Oram speaking on the radio on the BBC in 1971. So this is kind of, it's a really nice example because we can hear a little bit of the process of making music with Oramics.
Well, I was wanting to make some sort of trumpety sounds, but not exactly a trumpet. One doesn't want to copy sounds of normal instruments. And so I drew a wave pattern, and I gave that to the machine, and then I went and put some black dots on. Now this just gives me a number of pitches, one after the other. Let's hear those. Very dull. Now, we want to put vibrato, and we want to put reverberation, and we want to rephrase it and make it much more musical.
Yeah, so I think as you can hear, I don't know how much you're familiar with it. I should have actually maybe brought an example. I could play something later, but if you compare the sort of quality of the sound she's created there to, you know, early computer music or other forms of electronic music, I think you can really say that she has achieved her brief of having this kind of, that could almost be an acoustic instrument. Obviously, it's you know, subjective, but to my ears, like, that could be a cello through lots of reverb or something, you know, like it's, so it's kind of, amazing what she achieved with that kind of like modest grant and with some goodwill from people, just basically on her own, when she was, you know, competing with these, you know, really well-funded studios in, you know, Paris and Milan and at Philips, we were saying earlier, in Eindhoven, and Columbia Princeton Electronic Music Center in New York and all kinds of things. She was in touch with all these people, and really the sounds she was getting were, you know, different, but you could really put them alongside each other, and you could say that's from the expensive studio, or that, you know, like they were really, she had achieved an amazing amount. But unfortunately, as the machine came together in 1966, a mysterious problem happened, a mysterious falling out with her main engineer, who I actually interviewed a few years ago. And he gave me two different answers as to what had happened. And without Oram's take on it, we'll never really know. But all we know is in 1966, she fired Graham Wrench, who was the kind of the real brains behind getting her ideas transformed into electronics. So after that, she went back to working with other engineers, and she spent years kind of tweaking it and fiddling with it and just changing bits about it. And then I think by kind of 1970, 1971, she was getting pretty frustrated with it. I'm going to briefly go through some very brief conclusions about kind of like from reading through her technical notes and her own correspondence and stuff. I kind of came to the conclusion that, you know, although Oramics was ambitious, holistic, and a nuanced approach, it was in practice quite unreliable. She had like a nightmare trying to keep it in tune. Like if her fridge turned on, the tuning would change, you know, so there's a lot of work to be done on that. It was ungainly. It was kind of locked into her studio in Kent. It was absolutely untransportable. So in terms of like getting recognition for it, not very many people actually got to see it. She couldn't bring it to a concert. It was kind of over complex because it was a perpetual prototype and being forever fiddled with. There was redundant parts of it, parts that were like been tried out and then scrapped. And so like as I was, you know, looking at the machine in the collection of the Science Museum, I was like, there was like whole looms of wiring, all kinds of bits that were just kind of like hanging off and no idea. There's a lot of detective work to try and work out, like, what was she trying to do here and what was she trying to do there. The Oram archive has something like 600 quarter-inch tapes, and very little of that output is the Oramics machine. There's maybe 25, 30 tapes with some Oramics on it, and not much of it is of the kind of quality of the piece of music I was playing you as you walked in, which is a piece called Bird of Parallax. But it did sound amazing, and I think it can't be overstated what an amazing achievement it was for her to do that kind of on her own. So as I was saying, in about 1970 to 1972, she was getting pretty fed up with spending 99% of the time on maintenance and only 1% composing with this machine. And obviously through the 1960s, electronics had come on a long way, and from late 50s, where valves were the predominant technology, through transistors and diodes and solid state electronics. And then in the late 60s, early 70s, we get into integrated circuits, and like everything just gets much, much smaller. So, and I think perhaps inspired by the success of the Mini-Moog, I'm not sure. But I don't know if you know Moog modular synths, these enormous, great hulking things that were popular with very rich rock bands in the 60s. They released the Mini-Moog, which was a small keyboard instrument with the Moog sound. And that was their top seller for years. So Daphne Oram kind of came up with the idea of making a smaller, simpler version of Oramics, which she called Mini-Oramics. And so when I found that in the archive when I was doing the research, I found a kind of almost complete design, actually, which was something that was completely missing from the first Oramics machine, because as I said, it had been like all the bits had been like fiddled with and juggled about, and there's only two or three actual schematics from the original design that are in the archive. And so to try and create like a replica, a working replica in the manner that Daphne Oram had built the original machine, especially bearing in mind that it never really worked properly, wasn't a very tempting proposition for a not very rich PhD student such as myself. But I thought this idea of trying to build this unrealized synthesizer that she designed but never made and was actually within the technological means that I understood much better, like these small microchips I felt that was something I could tackle. So I decided to, as it was a practice-based PhD, I tried to build the Mini-Oramics. So obviously I have built it and it's here. But I just wanted to explain a little bit about my thought process behind that. So the first thing I did was to really interrogate Oram's design, which is about, I think it's 12, 15 pages long, all handwritten, with handwritten circuit diagrams and stuff. And I looked at how she was planning to do it. And as I was kind of going through it, and I tested little circuits, I built them in my studio, I tested little ways of doing things as Oram had planned. And I was finding that, you know, she'd obviously never built a prototype, and if she had done, she'd have bumped into some of these same problems I was having. So in the end, I decided to kind of privilege making a working instrument that follows her kind of artistic brief above making something that's an exact replica of what she was going to try and do first. So I kind of came up with this thing that my PhD supervisors didn't really like very much. I think they thought it sounded a bit crass. So I called it the what-if methodology. And what I was getting at was, what if a significant commercial interest had taken on and perfected Mini-Oramics and released it as a commercial product in the early 1970s. So that was kind of the brief for me trying to build this machine. And so that meant, obviously, I had limitations. I couldn't use microprocessors, and I couldn't, you know, there was lots of things. So basically, I've built it with very simple logic gates and operational amplifiers and things that would have been available at that time. It wasn't like using vintage components. I was just doing it in the way with contemporary components, but the equivalent of what you could get in the 1970s. And I also completely cheated on the framework. I had it laser cut. I was more interested in just getting the thing working. So that was kind of how I did it. And it took probably two and a half years of working on that at the same time as my other research. But eventually, obviously, I made it. And there was, initially quite a flurry of interest. It was on the news. That was nice. There was an interview on Radio 4. I went to Moog Fest, and I went to lots of other conferences and showed it off and so on. So this is sort of 2016, at which point my machine was still not really, it still had a few teething problems as well. I was having nightmares with static electricity building up as the plastic film goes over the plastic top, and there was all kinds of issues I was having. Mainly with the transport mechanism than the sort of electronics, but still I was, like Oram, I was struggling to keep it in tune and so on and so forth. But, but since then I've been still tinkering away with it and improving it, and quite a number of composers have worked with it now. So Sarah Anglis, Shiva Fisherecki, James Bully, I'm going to forget half of them, but and obviously me. So this next slide is just a kind of a little brief for the nerds. I can come back to it if you want, or maybe take a photo on your phone. But it basically just describes what the differences are between what I've built and what her original machine was. But the main one really is that the way the wave shapes are produced. My one, you don't feed in a drawn waveform into a slot. You actually, if I go back to the photo, so at the top here, where's the mount? These things that look like graphic equalizers are actually the wave shapers. So it has this, if you draw just like eight up and eight down, that's sort of theoretically a square wave. If you make them in a nine sine shape, that's theoretically a sine wave and so on. So it's kind of more immediate, more reliable, and more performable than the original analog option, but arguably less beautiful. And it also has this slightly different sound in that there's a kind of digital stepping between, so the waveform is not this lovely smooth thing. So then I had to add a filter on top to kind of smooth off the rough edges, as it were. But it's still, the first time I turned it on and I tried to write a line of music, I was kind of astonished how much like Oramics it sounded, so I was very, really happy. So yeah, I'll just play you a couple of little examples. We'll obviously have a play with the instrument later anyway, so. This was one of the first things my friend James Bully did, and I've kind of, I don't know, for anyone who saw the exhibition, you'll hear an echo of what I did here, because James has transcribed Messiaen's Horizon, or just the opening phrases from Olivier Messiaen's Horizon onto here, and that's the same as I did for the show here. I just had the first few bars of that on a loop where you could press the button, it would just play it once and stop it on a good day. Sometimes it do whatever it wanted, but so this is that. I did that Daphne Oram wasn't going to do with the Mini-Oramics is I made it to be really compatible with other like modular synthesizer equipment. So instead of having a complete bespoke self-contained unit as she was intending, I was like, well, it would be insane not to use like CV gate, like basically the standard for modular synthesis. So, and I also put on a whole nother channel that she never included that was kind of a rhythm channel that I can trigger drum sounds with, or I can automate other things with, or I can just, in the case of the exhibition here, I just use one dot to make the machine stop at the right place, and then you can press a button and it. So I've, you know, pimped it a little bit, but this next slide is like me rehearsing on the machine, but with some other synthesizers and stuff in the studio. I think just one other oscillator, and I'm using the rhythm track on the Oramics to just turn the other sequencer over just to create the rhythm that the other one's following, so basically the bass line. But yeah, you can do, yeah, it can integrate with other sort of studio equipment quite well, so any of the information that's generated here about the pitch and dynamics is easy to translate to a different synthesizer that's not this one, and vice versa, I can use other sequences and systems to control this synthesizer, so both ways around, which has been, you know, a lot of fun to play with and work with. So yeah, it's been quite a brief like overview of the work and research. I'm gonna like open it up to questions in a minute. And then we can switch over to the playing with the Oramics a bit. And then I was hoping some of you might like to come and kind of get stuck in and do some all you genius composers come and come and make some squeaky noises. So anyway, briefly, the main kind of conclusions to my research were that essentially I think there was a gap between like Moog modular synthesizers and the advent of like MIDI and home computers, where you know, like, so you've kind of got these very crazy, unapproachable interfaces with hundreds of jack cables, but also quite unsophisticated sequencing technologies. And then 10 years after that, you've got MIDI, where you can just do multiple lines of melody and dynamics all really easily from a computer or from a sequencer. So I think if Mini-Oramics had managed to have become a commercial instrument, it would have probably been superseded quite quickly, but for a time, in like from say 1973 to kind of 1978, it would have been still a really sophisticated and intuitive interface for electronic musicians. It would have still been cheaper than a computer, but a fair bit more expensive than kind of a VCS3 or one of the, or a Mini Moog or something like that. Its interface and sound were very different to anything else available at the time, and arguably maybe still is a little bit. Before I built it, I had no idea really whether it would be at all fun, you know, trying to write music in this day where we can just play anything into a computer and have it spit it back at us, or we can change it, we can quantize it, we can do all of that stuff so easily. And now we're working with something that doesn't even have copy and paste, you know. If you want to do a repetitive piece of music, you have to draw it out hundreds of times. But it's, you know, it's frustrating at times, but it's kind of more intuitive and less painstaking than I thought it might be. That's not to say, it's not to say that it's not painstaking, but, you know, I think, yeah, really the takeaway is, I think if it had come out before about 1975, 1976, it would have been, you know, it would have made quite a big impact. And I think, I like to think that, you know, had that happened, some of its practitioners would have carried on using it even as the other technologies came along, much like instruments like the Ond Martino are still kind of part of orchestral music now. Obviously, not many people are playing them or making them, but there is enough of a community around that, and there's enough works that are written for it, that it's still a thing, and it probably will be for the foreseeable future. And I would like to think that maybe Mini-Oramics would have fitted into that category, had or managed to get the. I mean, and it's quite sad because in a way, you know, her career peaked really in the early 60s before she built the Oramics machine. When it came out, it was kind of, as I said, sort of like chained to her studio in Kent, and not that much coverage was really done. She got a lot more exposure when she got the grant, for instance, in like 1961, than she did when she made the damn machine. So, and then as the 70s went on, she found it harder and harder to get funding and backup and support. But she pressed on. She, in the end, what happened was she wrote up the design for Mini-Oramics that she'd done in collaboration with another technician, whose name temporarily escapes me, apologies. And then she bought an Apple II computer, and she programmed her Oramic system into a computer. And she commissioned, you couldn't go and buy a sound card at that point or an interface, so she commissioned one. She had a local electronics engineer make her an audio interface that would work through the printer port on her Apple II computer, and she beavered away at that. And sadly, the discs have sat in the archive so long that they're not really readable, but a wonderful friend and colleague of mine, Sarah Anglis, who's also someone who's worked with the Mini-Oramics, is currently trying to save the discs and recreate Oram's software. And tantalizingly, in the archive, there is reference to her having programmed Handel's Water Music into her computer interface of Oramics. And she refers to it being on cassette tape, and of course there's no cassette tapes in the archive. That was most likely when she went into hospital in later life, because people knew that she had a house full of electronics. She was just get burgled all the time. Mm-hmm. So it's likely that those tapes were all just pilfered and recorded over, or who knows. Maybe one will come to light at some point, but it's kind of amazing to think she, you know, after all of that she'd achieved, then she wrote Oramics into her Apple II computer and put Handel's Water Music into it. And I wish we could hear it, but. Yeah, so that's kind of the intro. That's the very brief synopsis of my research and a very brief synopsis of that very specific part of Oram's life. Obviously, she was a very broad and versatile thinker, and she had all kinds of other things that she'd tried to do and got up to, and go, yeah, definitely read her book and so on. So here are some links that might be interesting. That's my email if you want to bother me more about it, you know, bug me all you like. That's my album releases, that's more like live recordings and experimental sound. This is the contact for the archive at Goldsmiths if you want to go and look at any of her archive. And this link is daphneoram.org is a kind of website that just is like a little bit of an Oram wiki page, and it's also, you can download my PhD thesis there if anybody wants to like get more stuck into Oramics. So that's, yeah, that's kind of it for the intro. So I'll do questions and then we'll flip over to a bit more playing with the machine. Does anyone have questions? Oh, please wait for the mic as well, because we're recording.
Just a short question, is there any time limit to the section that you made, or is it just a matter of how long your plastic is that can be as long as you want? Just
on here?
Well,
or on her?
On hers, but also on yours. Like
Well, yeah, it's finite, obviously, like it's as much film as you can fit on the spool. And I have to say, on the original machine, the film transport mechanism is pretty entirely baffling, and I actually, after, like, I spent a long time trying to get my head around it, because the route, the actual film route for the pitch control and the film route for the analog audio envelopes is different, and who knows why. And another thing that she was trying to do, which was always kind of in the original plan for Oramics, was to build a synchronized multi-track tape recorder that like hooks up to it. So you'd have 35 mil magnetic tape as well with like 10 tracks or 12 tracks on. So you'd write your Oramics line, rewind, rub it all out, and then, you know, do the next line. So you could really do like symphonic or, you know, multi-timbral works on it, but that never happened. There is a sort of, in the collection of the Science Museum, something that looked like a big kind of barrel or drum that was the beginnings of the multi-track tape recorder, but it never happened, unfortunately. But yeah, it's as much film as you can fit on the reel, essentially, and the same with this. And obviously, you can go slow and fast, so I don't really know exactly what the limit is. Like, there's a point where it's so slow that the marker pen marks are just too fat to have any resolution, obviously. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, this fella and then over there.
Thanks so much. I'm wondering, you know, because electronic music, you know, has some arguably one of the most interesting things, to be able to operate in a continuum of all kinds of parameters, and I think in your design, there's a lot of, you know, quantization of things that will run to be straight within some kind of a discrete lattice instead of being
in which design, sorry?
Your design, for example.
There's
that you were showing.
Oh, there's not quantization.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, my question is, in your design, it's actually, you know, possible to do just continuous flow of information of electricity, and also if in the original design, the RAM design, if you, what was she focusing on? Also, like being able to have very discrete steps and whatever parameters, especially in pitch, for example, or if she was really going for some kind of aesthetic where it would just freely draw and flow onto.
She definitely wanted both, but like I say, there's no copy and paste and there's no quantize. It's down to how accurately you draw. But yeah, she would be more towards the free flow and the kind of, you know, syncopated rhythms and the kind of the changing of the timbre within the notes and all of those like nuanced things and the fine vibrato just coming in at the end of the note. She was all about that real luscious, organic, acoustic sounding composition. But obviously, like I come from essentially, like I got into music in a big way through kind of like dance music and making techno and drum and bass and all that sort of stuff. So I of course put on the rhythm tracks. And also like my early experiments on here were quite sort of hard and rhythmic. Mm-hmm. So it, actually if I flip over to the camera, I can, well I'll do it in a minute, but yeah, when you see the kind of grid on the thing, it's only a guide.
Right.
It's not anything to do with what you draw. It's only you can use it to divide up time on the sheet. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. And just
if
I have any question.
Yeah, we've got plenty of time.
If the circuitry is maybe freely open source to the people that are trying to build or trying to adapt.
Well, most of it's in my PhD.
Okay.
Obviously, if you go and make loads of money from it, I'll be a bit grumpy. it's got worldwide patents, and I'll litigate.
Thanks. I mean, you said something in the beginning that I found a bit, you quoted her, I guess, but I found it a bit disturbing that it took her years to make something that resembled music. What does it actually mean?
Oh, no, it didn't take her years to make something that resembled music. She made amazing music her whole life, but it took her a long time to get the Oramics machine to a point where it could make a series of notes in a row, you know, like literally
so,
just...
When you had a series of notes in a row, didn't you?
Well, this could be a semantic discussion, but she got bits of it working. Like, okay, here's a dynamic line. And then she got like, here's some plinky plonky. She got all that working. But the point where she started to do what she wanted with it, which was to like have the line of notes and the dynamics and the reverberation and follow her own brief, that's what I was referring to as something resembles music. Mm-hmm. Basically,
yeah,
I was referring to her own brief.
Yeah. So that when there was, so first it was dull in the example from the second two, I think it was, but then there was reverb and vibrato, and that made it much more musical.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there are all these assumptions of what musicality is and what music is. And
well, she was very, very, very opinionated in what she thought music was and should be. Yeah, like, I don't agree with everything. She thought, and I'm sure she wouldn't like a lot of my music, but I could still appreciate her as an inventor and as an amazing woman, you know.
Because there was also this claim, I think it was from 61, where the Oramics could make more variation in timbre than electronic music so far, and that also I found it a bit tricky to...
Not 1961, no.
When did you say that?
That was me saying that.
Okay.
So I was saying that if you listen to something like Max Matthews and you listen to Oramics, say both from 1967 or 8, there is something a lot more organic. Let me play some.
Would you say that is a little more limited in
time? I'm not a Stockhausen expert. I can't really claim.
You
don't
have to be an expert in Stockhausen.
Yeah, no, I know, but I can't. Like, isn't that quite electroacoustic? Isn't there quite a lot of like? Or is
no,
it?
No, I mean, well, there's a pure tape version, and there's a piece where a version where the tape is combined with the percussion.
Yeah, so I would argue that in terms of what she was talking about, if you're going to use percussion and piano, that's what she's trying to do electronically, to get those acoustic sounds to be more, to get electronic sounds to be more like the acoustic sounds that Stockhausen's using in Contact, for instance. So let's play. Let's try this. Thank you.
The occasionally friendly sound.
So, yeah. So I mean, that was the studio where Max Matthews was working on the early, you know, Bell Labs with the early computer music. Mm-hmm. That's the kind of thing Oram was listening to when she was saying, I want my music to sound more organic. Mm-hmm. That's my point. And like, whether you're with her or against her, like, that was her passion, was for this like more fluid, organic and intuitive way of, you know, she didn't want to have to program a computer to be able to like draw a wave like that kind of thing. Yeah. Does that answer?
Well, it explains her point of view.
Yeah, I mean, she had a very strong point of view. Yeah. That's unarguable. And arguably, maybe perhaps why, you know, maybe she did cross some people or piss some people off, and it could be partly why, you know, she was unable to get that further support she needed. But there's also other factors, I think, like rampant sexism and some other things probably had something to do with that. But and jealousy, I think, and all kinds of things. But no, she was very, very, very specific about what she thought music was and should be. Yeah.
Well, one last question, sorry. But you said that she was also a master of the concrete techniques, and are there compositions that you can listen to?
Yeah, there's albums.
Okay.
Yeah, so, I mean, the piece I was playing at the beginning, I don't know if you heard, is a piece called Bird of Parallax that she wrote for a sort of experimental ballet in the very early 70s. And that piece has in it Oramics phrases from her machine, but also kind of quite thing. But I mean, one thing that I would say, well, there's much more of that material than Oramics material. So if you listen to like a Daphne Oram album, like I can play something, but, yeah, she was like, this is the piece she wrote for the, oh actually I'm doubting myself now, it might not be. I think this is more of a concrete technique. She did a lot of things like advertisements and film soundtracks. She worked, she did the soundtrack for The Innocents, which was the sort of Jack Clayton's in film interpretation of the turning of the screw. She did adverts for Lego and washing powder and all kinds of things. Costain mining, randomly. I wonder if here's the Lego ad. Do you want to hear the Lego ad?
Yeah. Lego. He's off to pioneer the empty spaces of the moon with Lego, his wonderful building bricks. Build bridge.
Lego build it.
Lego build it.
Lego build
it.
Lego
build
it.
Build moon tractor.
Lego build it.
Lego build it. Lego build it.
Build missile defense center.
Lego build it.
Lego build it.
Lego, the wonderful building toy, builds a whole wide world for you.
Yeah, so, I mean, she really did support herself with that kind of commercial work, and a lot of the time when Oramics was in development, she was just completely, chasing money and commissions to be able to pay Graham to finish building the Oramics machine. It kind of worked like that. Did you have a question? You had a question, sorry. Can you pass the mic? Thanks.
Hi, thanks.
Thank you.
I have several questions. The first is, what do you hope, if you see a future for your machine, what do you hope to be in an ideal world?
I'd love for more composers to kind of spend longer with it and make more long form pieces. So I guess the few projects where we've had composers work with it, it's always been quite a short time scale, not very much funding and so on. So I'd love someone to, or several people to be able to go for 6 months and just concentrate on that. So some kind of like funding or project for that would be amazing. I kind of want to make a version 2 that would be duophonic. I think a polyphonic one, like there's just not enough kind of real estate on the thing to do properly, but I think a duophonic one, so you can do counterpoint melody, would be really nice. So I would love, if anyone's got buckets of cash, to commission me to do that, I would be very happy. But I mean, really, if nothing else happens with it, I'm kind of pretty happy in what it's done for Daphne Oram's legacy. I'm happy for what it's done for my career. It's been great. You know, I've been all over the world with it. I've been to Mergfest, I've been to Brazil, I've been all around the UK, it's been here. But yeah, I think more long form and in-depth composing with it would be great.
The other question was, what intrigued you to Daphne in the first place?
Okay. It was literally like a job that I applied for. So I'd never heard of her. And it was a PhD studentship that Mick Grierson and Tim Boone, so Goldsmiths Science Museum, had put together because they'd finally located the original machine, which had been sold off to a guy in France, and it was in a barn. And the archive had been donated to Goldsmiths, and they knew each other and they got their heads together and they got what's called AHRC, so Arts and Humanities Research Council funding, to fund a student, a doctoral student, to study her and create things that she might have made. So I was just lucky. Someone said, you should apply for this. And I did. And he also recommended me to them. And so yeah, it was like a job. I went to an interview.
There was a book that's written on her, and
No, that she wrote.
She wrote a book on herself.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
great. Yeah. That's called An Individual Note of Music, Sound, and Electronics. It's called An Individual Note, and then that's sort of like a subscript of Music, Sound, and Electronics.
Yeah. So I guess a lot can be found there. But throughout your research, what is the most surprising thing that you found from the other activities that she was doing that you haven't mentioned?
I mean, she's full of surprises and paradoxes and things, but she spent 3 or 4 years touring around a megalithic ancient sites exploring resonance.
Awesome.
And wrote an as yet unpublished essay about that. That's a really good read. Like, that's a reason to go to the archive, just that essay. It's amazing.
Sorry, one more question. In terms of like how she would make
her
notes and her studies, because she seems like she, it seems like she's a person that would go on forays for years at a time to just study something in particular.
Yeah.
Was her note making already systematized in such a way that she predicted that somebody would come along and study her in the future, or was it?
Oh, that's a good question. Yeah, I'd say some of it kind of falls more into the kind of manifesto and legacy camp, and some of it's obviously notes for her to refer back to.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think certainly she thought she was important enough that people would come back to her. Sadly, you know, her older years were quite, you know, she was very poor, she didn't have many people around her, yeah, it was, and she'd fallen out with a lot of her family, so it was, yeah, difficult. But yeah, I think she certainly was writing for other people as well, and she'd write articles in, you know, she'd write articles in academic journals and stuff, and they were all very opinionated and very, this is how it should be, you know. She was, yeah, quite political, philosophical in how she treated music and composing.
I'm a visual artist.
Hi.
And I wondered if it could be used by a visual artist as well to compose.
Yeah, and that's the question like a number of visual artists have asked me before. And what I would say is, I'm going to change it over, this is a good moment to change it over to the camera, because I can show you what I mean. But essentially it's quite, you can put any image you want through it, but it is parameterized. So if you do a line from top to bottom, you're going to be crossing vibrato, pitch, three different volume controls, you know what I mean? So it's, so like pitch, octave, two oscillator volumes, wave A and wave B, how much reverb, how much vibrato or pitch bend, and then this is the rhythm section that I had to put in because I love techno. If you do a line across that, it's going to like trigger, but I'm going to let you play with it so you can come and do something. So what I thought was for the rest, is there any more questions or should we? Wait for the mic, please.
Yeah, I was just wondering, since you mentioned the connection to other places and what other people were doing, if you know anything about her response to Xenakis's Ubik system that was developed later?
I don't, I'm sorry. I know she will have been aware of it. But that was kind of late 70s, am I right? I can't remember exactly.
I don't remember exactly, but it would have been.
I mean, it also developed over a number of years. So. Yeah, I mean, yeah, that's definitely something, to be honest, I should have researched more in the context of this PhD and sadly didn't get around to, so I'm not an expert. But I'd say, like, she always had her finger on the pulse. She always knew what was going on. She took all the magazines and all the journals. She wrote to all these people. But she definitely went to Paris to, like, see what they were up to, but much earlier, in the late 1950s, she went with the BBC, and she went to the Brussels Expo with the BBC, where, Pavilion where Xenakis had the big multi-channel? So she certainly saw that, so she certainly knew about him. I don't know what she thought of the Ubik, though, I'm sorry. Are we all done for questions? Oh, there's one more.
Thanks for the presentation. Really interesting. Just one short question. So, since you basically went through a lot of her archives and her notes and so on, so maybe you know the honest and in-depth reason why did she choose like such a synesthetic approach to composing in the first place? Why the graphics? I mean, did she had some sort of childhood involvement or
interesting. It's a really good question, and luckily I've got some insight into that. So, as I said, like in response to your question, like Oram was always writing about her approach to things, sometimes in this kind of slightly manifesto-y kind of way, sometimes slightly. She was trying to establish her place in the canon with that kind of thing, you know, going on the radio and doing this, writing in the journals and stuff. And she cites kind of two things, really. One was reading Leopold Stokowski as a sort of 18 or 19 year old student, just before she actually never went to university, she went straight to the BBC
Was she reading of Stokowski, the musicologist, or?
I'm sorry, I can't remember off the top of my head. You'll have to forgive me because all of this research happened for me quite a long time ago, so I don't keep absolutely everything. But certainly she refers to Stokowski as having inspired, you know, her starting to think about that idea of a composer giving information to a machine for it to turn directly into sound. And then the other thing in her kind of own history of, as she's written it, of her musical progress is an anecdote about going to a BBC training course, like when she was still a very young woman, maybe 22, and seeing an oscilloscope for the first time, where she spoke into a microphone and she can see the waveform on the screen. And the story goes that she asked the technician or the teacher, well, could you do that in reverse and draw the waveform and hear the sound? And he was like, brushed her off and said, don't be stupid, whatever. That's how she tells it. So that would be what Daphne Oram would say. Having looked at the kinds of designs she was looking at in the 1950s, so if you do feel like dipping into my thesis, there's a lot of the images of like earlier versions of what she was trying to do that were much more kind of basic. So things like drawing outlines on a cut out bit of paper and having it be read through a slit by an optical sensor, you know, like much. So a lot of things that were kind of electromechanical, where the pitch would be derived from a motor speed, and then the timbre would be something vibrating within that realm. Things like that, and a lot of things where she was trying to manipulate tape to do the same thing. So she was like, well, maybe using a potentiometer we can draw voltages onto tape and then read them back, that kind of thing, you know, if you had like a slide potentiometer. So she was sort of like thinking of this stuff certainly throughout the 50s, and then I believe when she got the grant in the early 60s, she still didn't really know how it was to be achieved. And I'm not sure where she, I guess like the reversed oscilloscope was in her head somewhere, because that's the sort of solution they went with in the end with the CRT. And really interestingly, the volume controls, the sort of, you know, I said there was the four film channels or five that were the volume controls, they actually worked in the same way, and they had a dot on the CRT following the line you draw. So she had like little 1-inch CRTs built into the surface of the machine with like a sensor hood above, similar to the way the waveforms were made. So it was pretty bonkers. Anyway, I digress. Stokowski and the reverse oscilloscope is my best guess. All right, cool. So I said I'd record this. So I'll play something, and then if you want, don't really know how to work this thing. Just use it like once a year. Is it recording? Record. Oh yeah, there's a red light flashing. It's promising. Okay, cool. So I'm going to play you this piece, which is actually the piece you saw in the video, but without all the rest of the synths. And then I'm going to invite you to come and draw squiggles. And I don't know how we're going to, obviously I don't think everybody can probably draw a squiggle, so I don't know how we're going to organise that, but some people might just want to watch. Thank you.
So that's...
that's a piece that's kind of designed to be with other bits and bobs, as you saw in the video with the... And these dots, I'm just drawing myself a tempo to kind of continue it at some point and like link up to other machines. But there's a very pragmatic reason why I chose to play that piece, which is maybe not the most finished one. It's because there's loads of blank film at the end that you can squiggle on. So that's what the order of the day is. So does someone want to have a go? Yes, you have a question. We have to have the mic, we're being recorded.
Is it possible?
On the nerd sheet, it says that this machine is based on a diatonic scale, right?
No, it's just like normal.
Because the earlier versions, it's like also work with micro,
micro tuning.
Yeah.
So no, I mean the way. I'm not musically trained in that kind of traditional orchestra way, so I don't exactly know what a diatonic scale is, but it's basically the standard Western scale, like C to B and then next octave. Chromatic, that's the bunny. Yeah. But that said, you have got the analog control of pitch, so if you were really dedicated, and you can also, you could. Change the oscillator characteristics so that, you know, 1 volt doesn't equal 1 octave, because like in synthesized analog synths, generally 1 volt in control voltage adds up to 1 octave in pitch. So there's ways around it. And with the vibrato or analog pitch control, you could tune the steps to be fractions of a semitone. So
So that was intentional, like those little with somebody, right?
Yeah, that was intentional, but
okay.
Yeah, you could do it in a much more precise way if you wanted. Yeah, you could.
Can I add something to that?
Yeah.
Because now that you ask this, I mean, it's actually surprising that he then makes reference to Varese's ideas about this grand connotation, because for Varese, the main attraction of this was to get rid of equal temperature and tuning.
Okay, so it was me that made the link between Varese. I don't remember Oram mentioning him, but I've read passages by Varese where he talks about, you know,
this machine, this graphic,
giving a score to a machine to be read. Maybe that's why she didn't cite him, because she wasn't into that. I don't know, but yeah, it was me that made that link, not definitely Oram. You're all very shy. Come and squiggle. How to write music, but then you can do the extended technique afterwards. So, someone say a melody, say like the notes and all.
Maybe I can zoom in a little bit.
C, B flat, what are the notes? Egg. Okay. E. G. Okay, then what's the next word?
Scramble.
Yeah, I don't have an S. I can do Campbell. E flat, you want next? E flat is S. Okay. Well, let's just start with that. So, like, if I. Is going to scribble with this, the polite thing to do is to do this, what I'd call the three blobs of silence.
So on each of the volume tracks, we start at the bottom, and then when you finish your phrase, also do the three blobs of silence at the end. It's only polite. So now, see, we've got a bit of a leftover something going on. We'll turn down the speed. It's about here. It's about 2 centimetres in that way. So, if I play my new wonderful egg scrambled melody, we get nothing at all, which is quite deliberate. So then, there's just pitch. We have to have dynamics. So let's draw some kind of dynamic for each one. And we'll go up and down with that one. So theoretically now we can hear something. This one's a mistake, and I go too high. Then it will probably, so let's draw it. So this is the eraser. It's pure alcohol and a cloth. So let's say that did do that. So I think what's going to happen is it's going to see this volume, then that one, then that one, then that one, then that one. So I think it's going to kind of oscillate between the two. But who knows? It's a bit chaotic. But
there's on the notes as well. If there's like a bunch of them stacked
records. Yeah. So it will just what it, the logic of it is whatever it sees the latest, it will change to. So if you have a diagonal line, it will be like dot 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 dot. If you have like a cross, that's not part of the syntax of the machine. It's going to like jump between the two things. So we can hear. There's some other controls here that kind of control how quickly it can react to things. So I'm going to change them all to really quick, so we can see what happens. Turn the speed down. So yeah, it just doesn't read it very well. Who knows, really? Actually, if you look at the little red lights there, you should be able to see what's happening. So it will be way. So it will be this. See what's happening on that row of lights there. Not now, but now. Yeah, it's jumping around here. Oh, actually, it's not quite telling you the truth. Later stage where it will actually decide which one it's seeing. So it's just going to see, it's going to tell you I'm seeing the six of ones or whatever. But there's a later stage down the way where it actually picks. So yeah, the lights are going to be on. Anyway, that's like a very simple line of melody. So let's we'll do some other dynamics on the B channel. It's monophonic with two timbres, two wave shapes. Yeah. So that's that. But you can also offset one pitch to the other. So at the minute, I have the B channel one octave higher than the other one. So let's hear that. Stick on a bit of So this is a bit of, what do you call that thing, vibrato? And a bit of reverb. So let's start with a lot of reverb. Let's have a bit of reverb at that point, and then let's go up to there and whatever, down again. So that should all sound a bit more alive with the reverb. We can hear the very slow vibrato. Sorry? It's got a row of, so each of these white lines, like not the, the black bits are the in-between spaces, but each white row here is like represented by one infrared LED and one infrared sensor. So it is actually a digital reading, it's not an analog, because it's selecting that one, that one, that one, that one. It's not like a true analog reading. So that's why I have these slew controls, they control the rate of change. So you'd have them set high if you're doing a slow, droney piece. You'd have them set low if you're doing a fast or busy piece. Yeah. Yes, that's what all of these tiny screwdriver adjustments are for. And this is actually a massive problem Oram had that she couldn't get past, was she was obsessed with opacity. She was obsessed with it having to be a hard yes or no on the drawing medium. And I was like, well, it's stupid not to be able to draw it with a pen. She was on about, like, she tried out photographic inks and all kinds of things, and eventually with Oramics, the first one, she was using black electrical tape for the, like, better opacity. And that's not really drawing. So I was really like, it has to be something you can just draw. Otherwise, I don't feel like it's fulfilling her brief. So there's a little circuit called a comparator. So actually, like, when you hold up the film and you see the bit that's drawn, like, 90% of the light comes through the bit that's drawn on. You know, it's not very opaque at all. Because there's a little circuit called a comparator, it can just see the difference and say, that's a hard yes or no. So, yeah, if she'd known about comparators a lot earlier, she'd have saved herself a lot of time. But isn't hindsight a wonderful thing? Where's my artist? Yeah. Me? No, I haven't really. The one thing that is really handy is, because it's an infrared system, I can use a red marker to make notes. So I can draw out a whole tempo and framework, and it won't make a sound. So that's a really useful tool. So red, purple, orange, doesn't matter. You can draw the whole structure of the piece, pencil it all in, and then, yeah, only when you go with this sort of quite blue, it's actually, and funnily enough, the machine is calibrated just for this specific brand of marker pen, this particular type. And once I did, in the earlier days, I did a talk at this Flat Pack Film Festival in Birmingham, and I was like, I'm going to prepare for my talk, I'm going to buy myself some new marker pens, it's all going to be wonderful. And then I tried to do this similar demo, and didn't read anything, because this new marker pen had a much more warm orangey black. And so I literally, in the middle of the talk, had to recalibrate the whole machine to work, because all my other pens had run out. And then after that, I learned my lesson, and I ordered like 50 of them. So yeah, now I've got like thousands of these things. Artist, you need to do more. It is not enough. Or is it a group effort? Okay. It's like, which group? This one's a reverb, so you only really get much of an effect if it's quite high, if I'm honest, like up in that area. But you can do like little peaks on the, also like the volume of the thing has to be high for it to have a big
impact.
Yeah, so that's the one that's currently an octave higher. Yeah. That's volume, yeah, and same there, and same for you.
It's better.
Yeah, all of it is fiddleable with. So in a minute I'll show you the timbre controls as well. Yeah, it's that's the advantage of my design rather than hers, but the disadvantage is it has this horrible sort of high-pitched, not harmonically related, like aliasing sound. So that's why it has the... so that's vibrato, or pitch bend. So if you do that, it's like pitch bend. And if you do that, it's like vibrato. Do you see what I mean? But with the trick with the vibrato is you should really end and start and end in the middle. Otherwise, it's like detuning your violin, kind of thing. Exactly, something like that. All right, let's give it a go.
Thank you.
Anyway,